Welcome, everyone. This is Pollen Needles, and you're listening to Lotro Players News, where we take a look at the latest news in Lotro and hear Lotro players. And this week we have with us Terry Adwin.
Hi.
And Calabathian.
Ain't nobody here but us chickens.
You're calling us chickens?
I'm not a chicken, excuse you.
Right, we can't be, because then people would be smacking us in hobnanigans. We would fear the advent of hobnanigans each and every time it came around, instead of just loathe it.
I thought you were going to say is because we were...
I just ignore
is that
it.
We were chick... All right, Yes, some might say that we are chickens because we try to avoid as much as possible because we're afraid of getting smacked.
Well, I wasn't going to go there, but you know what, Pine? I guess if the shoe fits, let's lace that thing up.
Okay, that is... Right, let's head into our show, and we'll begin with update 29.5.1.
Super important update.
Super important update. Well, if you're a Voster player...
This is going to take us a while, guys, so bear with us, okay? Be patient.
Voster players can now use their steel tokens to receive anniversary rewards by speaking to Throck near the entrance to Grand's Foot.
Woohoo!
Okay, we're done. Also, hooray, because we can finally, you know, get stuff with our tokens. I haven't even been able to go look and see what we can get. I don't know what we can get.
Well, they didn't say that they added anything new this year, right?
Yes, but I didn't even... I mean, last year it was just, you know, I was still a baby warg. There wasn't much I could, you know, get anyway. Of course, last year I was also dying a lot. But anyway, I digress. I still die a lot, but I'm not a baby like rank one warg that, you know, everyone actually guns for because they're tender and juicy.
Okay, so now you're a...
No, you're a higher level warg than everybody guns for because you bite them.
Yeah, but at least there's biting going on that makes sense instead of, you know, me just appearing going, just let me, true. Oh Lord, I'm dead. You know, I'm going to hit something. No, I'm not.
Ooh.
No, I'm okay. I'm okay.
They're all just beating on puppies.
Seriously, don't kick a puppy. Someone call the ASPCA. They're kicking puppies over here. Putting
now,
them to the sword.
I don't know if there are any background updates on top of that, but that is the only thing, at least, that the players would notice.
Yes. Thank you for your patience, everyone, for this very long release note portion of our podcast tonight.
And on to other news, we have a community update from ET7 CEO and founder Robin Floden. And he says the following. First and foremost, I'd like to warmly welcome to the Daybreak community to the ET7 family. It's been long overdue, and I'd like to personally thank you for your patience these past few months as our companies sort things out operationally. I'd also like to formally introduce myself and provide you the lay of the land, so to speak, as a start of our partnership. My name is Robin Floden, founder and CEO of ET7. Like you, I love games. I grew up playing them, and now I dedicate my life's work to making games alongside our development studios. Daybreak owns some of the most beloved games and franchises in the world, and everyone at ET7, including myself, have been longtime fans. In fact, Daybreak celebrates some remarkable milestones recently. DC Universe Online celebrated a decade of heroics. EverQuest entered its 22nd year, while Dungeons & Dragons Online is now in its 15th year. and we intend to continue this incredible legacy for many more years to come. Many of these games, while successful and continually supported, have had their unique challenges. Many of these challenges are long-standing and important, but due to their scope and or other situations, haven't been feasible to address. All of us want this to change. Over the last few months, I have been busy at work, getting up to speed, spending a lot of time with Daybreak teams, and also listening, reading, absorbing the community feedback across all the games. As you can imagine, given the long history, there's a lot to digest, but I'm making good progress and have learned a ton and continue to do so. I want to assure you that this effort is a priority for me, EG7, and Daybreak. We have been listening to the community feedback and all of your questions and concerns. This is an ongoing effort, and as we make progress, the goal is to develop specific plans to create an even better game experience for all of our players. Just know that all of us, our community, Daybreak, and EG7 are fully aligned and committed, and we will want to improve. I also understand that implementing significant solutions takes time and does not usually happen overnight. Our plan is to first identify some of the most pressing pain points you, the Daybreak community, are experiencing today and to determine the right course for immediate action. This includes implementing systems, adding tools, resources, or people where needed, and continuing the crucial work that has already begun at the studios. We will share specific details with you when we have them, and I hope you will join us in our journey of making great games together. Until then, Robin Floden, CEO, EG7.
So, may I address the rather large pachyderm in the room?
the elephant in the room?
Yes. They didn't mention LOTRO. The irony being, they didn't mention LOTRO in this when we're actually in the middle of our 14th anniversary celebration.
Well, I mean, 15 is more.
I guess they wanted... My guess is that whichever... They didn't want to mention every single game, and that since DDO was a year ahead of us, they decided to choose that one, since that was the bigger number.
I guess.
Well, that's just my guess on the matter. We can only hope that he wasn't intending to leave us out in whatever is to come.
Right.
And I'm sure that people, when they say, what's your biggest pain point in LOTRO? And everyone at Evernight is going to yell, lag!
Yeah, because that was my next comment was, you know, the biggest pain point in LOTRO would be, you know, legendaries. The LIs.
Well, the other L word.
Because otherwise, it's that long, long ride, slow ride, anywhere in the Shire, and or between Bree and Trestle Bridge. Crippling, y'all. It's crippling. Pain points in LOTRO. And then any time you get on a stable master, you know, stable goat in Moria. So I'm just saying.
Well,
if they're gonna say stuff about pain points, maybe that's the reason why they didn't say anything, mention LOTRO, because there's a lot of them.
There are a few of them in DDO also.
And I'll since I've been with DDO anyway.
Yes. And I'm pretty sure EverQuest has a few of them also. So.
I've never actually played Evercrack. I mean, EverQuest.
Neither have I, so. Let's now head into the LOTRO Beacon issue 202. where it looks like they're over at the Wildwood is my best guess from that little screenshot there.
So let's it's a much better picture than one of the other ones from the past where, you know, they have, you know, everyone around a campfire and there's like, you know, someone sneaking up behind the minstrel and the minstrel's fixing to get got. I mean, it's a much more serene picture this time around a campfire.
Oh, but who knows what's happening just out of camera shot.
It's true. There might just be someone over there trying to come over here and get one of these guys just in the background. Someone maybe fixing to get got again. I don't know. I mean, it's Lotro. It could happen.
Yeah. Let's head into the community spotlight, where Fibro Jedi has updated his guide to requests, mounts, and rewards for the 14th anniversary. Get a comprehensive guide to the anniversary event over on his blog. Dekamalu now has the Stable Master stands to view in their latest set of images to their housing site.
And that is STANDS and not, you know, STANS stands, which is completely different. We are not standing Stable Masters. It's a stand. So I don't know. Some of the Stable Masters are actually pretty cool. So maybe I stand a Stable. Anyway.
I have completely, absolutely no idea what you just said there.
That's okay. Just, you're not cool and hip. Just continue. Just okay. Going. Just continue.
Well, that's well established. Let's head into the weekly comment. What crop would you farm if you lived in Middle Earth and had to be a farmer?
Why do we have to pick just one?
Well, there is that little detail.
To be honest, it kind of depends on what my goal would be as a farmer. If it's just, you know, being stable and, you know, kind of, you know, making sure that there's always, you know, I can always get money out of my farming, it would probably be something like wheat, because that's always going to be, you know, in demand, because so much is used, you know, wheat is used in so many things. But if I wanted to be all fancy and try to actually make, like, money, like, you know, bags of gold money, I would try to develop a nice strain of pipeweed and sell that.
All right. What do you say, Terry?
I still want to know why we only have to pick one. Because as every good farmer knows, you don't just stick with one crop. You have to rotate your crops. Otherwise, the soil gets worn out over time. So,
you do have a point.
Potatoes,
there.
Cabbages, wheat,
all right.
Carrots, mushrooms.
Hogs, dogs, beans, greens, but I mean,
hogs, you don't grow hogs. You don't plant them in the ground like they're crops.
That was not the reference I was making.
Yes. Yes, you do have a point there where you have the rotation.
Not to mention all the fruit trees. Cherry trees and apple trees and pear trees.
All right. If I was going to have one crop, at least the third that would be the money crop as opposed to the nutrient getting one or the fallow field, would be the, I'll say spring barley, because we're going to have for pies.
Yes, grains are always a good thing to do.
Right, and since spring barley is used for making the pie crust that you need for all of those pies that you're going to be needing. So any other ideas on that, or we'll leave it at that?
Well, I suppose we could always talk about what nobody else wants to talk about, the flowers that you can totally get, you know, a crop of non-vegetable things, non-fruit things, like, you know, violets and all that.
Oh, don't worry. The flowers are probably growing in the fallow field automatically, right? Let's head into fan site news. Last week, we needed some stilts.
Well, not all of us. Just Sans.
Okay, Sans needed some stilts, yes. I admit that there are a couple of occasions where I think my characters could have used them also.
That's true. We could all use stilts, I guess, on occasion.
Over on Lotro Streams is your first stop to find Lotro on Twitch. This week, Winnie runs further adventures. Wicked Eye Gaming goes in a mission of discovery, and Lady Faye levels on Laurelin. And also on Twitch, Bloodborne gets sick beasts.
No, beats.
Beats. Oh.
Yes, he's going to drop those sick beats. He has become a rapper, apparently. No, I don't know. I'm just saying. But if he's got those sick beats, and it's B-E-A-T-S and not B-E-E-T-S, which is yet another crop you could farm. Yeah, you don't want him to get sick if you're farming.
Beats are gross, anyway. Though.
Now you know why beasts came to my mind is the beets.
Yeah, because I mean, if you're getting sick beasts as well, then you're in trouble because, you know.
Well, then don't eat them.
It's not good.
Right.
As long as you're not hunting them for food.
Ancient right. Evil, what do we do? What do we say to ancient evil children? You don't eat it.
Muckshifter becomes a limited edition. And Zagog gets legendary.
Wait a minute. How do you become a limited edition? Do you, like, kill off everybody around you or something? I'm a little worried.
I don't know.
I'm a little worried. I don't... okay.
I guess you could watch this Twitch stream and find out.
I'm almost afraid to now.
Over on YouTube, June teaches you about virtues, Mana Pots goes on a lore master journey, and Ami streams as a new player.
Okay, I'm here. They better teach you about virtues, but teaching people about vices would probably be way more intriguing. JS, just saying, y'all.
Okay, well, I guess you have a blacksmith to teach about vices, because you need to use them in order to shape the tools properly, right?
Yes, those are the vices I meant. Let's continue.
Yes.
And oh, by the way, Sam mentioned Soylent Green is made of ancient evil. Only if that ancient evil is people. Maybe.
A day on the green fields began last weekend, and TD Growl recorded day one on Ladgerville, so you could check on the link in the beacon to see that.
Wait, a day on the green fields lasts more than one day?
Apparently. You know how these things go. I mean, it starts with one day, and then it ends up with two, and then you have like 3 weeks of the concert series before the actual concert.
Yes.
Like Weatherstock. Okay. I mean, Weatherstock is like a 6 week event.
Yeah, it started as a 1 day event.
Started as a 1 day event. Ago. Yeah, now it's like six weeks of.
Well,
I'm surprised we haven't actually heard about this year's Weatherstock. It's almost May. It is May.
Yeah, it is May. Yes, it's May Day.
It's May Day.
May Day! May Day!
No word yet on Weatherstock.
May Day! May Day! We haven't heard about Weatherstock. Please, SOS.
Light the beacons.
Yes.
Gondor has lit the beacons. When is Weatherstock?
For our screenshot of the week, This lovely classic image of a rainbow in the Shire was submitted recently by someone who didn't give a name for credit. But thank you anyway. You can submit your screenshots by emailing to lotro@sandstonegames.com. And that is the beacon for this week. So let's head into our store sales. And Terry, what's on sale this week?
Well, this is our final weekend for Double Points in the Lotro store. And then our coupon code is for a fall injury immunity times 5 with the code NimbleToes, which I think is fantastic. And then also don't forget that you can use the coupon code SAVEBILBO one time per account through May 9th, which gets you the Further Adventures of Bilbo Baggins for free for your account for ever and ever, which Pineleaf doesn't need to use because he's a lifer and his VIP will never run out. But for those of us that might not always be VIP, Save Bilbo will get you those adventures from now until the end of time. And then we have 20% off select quest packs, the 100% XP boost, Mithril coins, and Max Morale and Power Scrolls now through May 6th.
Okay, but we'll be able to do the adventures now through the end of time once we use it. The coupon code is only actually available through May 9th.
I said through May 9th.
Okay, because I missed it. I just wanted to make sure, because if I missed it, someone else may have.
Possible. So, let's head to Terry's pick of the week. What did you pick? Looks like cosmetic-y.
It's a new outfit by Cosmetic Lotro, on a mission, which, uses some of the cosmetics that you can barter for with the Gabilica Quartermaster when you do the insane amount of missions that you need to do in order to get rep with them. She's showing them off on a Bjorning, and then it's, couple of other pieces with the Protectors of Wilderland. It's a nice rugged look, and it does make mention of the fact that you cannot dye the leg pieces, and I don't know why you cannot dye the leg pieces, because it doesn't make any sense to give you dyeable top when you can't dye the bottom, because then you can't match them together, but yeah, it's frustrating. But
those
it's a great
pains again.
I mean, it's a great look.
It is.
Then, let's into our week in gaming. Terry Adwin, what were you up to?
Not a lot, because I took a little bit of a break from Lotro to celebrate the fact that I didn't really need to do missions. Speaking of missions, I did not do missions all week, and it felt great. Because I got my fancy pocket. And so I don't really... I mean, I'm still going to probably end up doing some missions, because I have to get... Now the essences to fill out the essence slots in the fancy pocket. But I did lead the way through the Rhythm set on Tuesday, which was especially hilarious because as the hunter in the group, I'm supposed to be like at the back, but I was the one that the Guardian decided to put on follow and go through with her eyes closed. So I was in the thick of the fighting despite the fact that I really didn't need to be in the thick of fighting. But we got through it. We didn't even really get lost. We dropped down a hole at one point because we were trying to get that last supply crate in the mine, but we only had to make one pass through the spider area, for which Sans was eternally grateful. and we went in one side and we went all the way through it, and then we went up to the other side, realized we still needed one crate, went back to figure out where the heck we missed it, and it was in some weird pocket zone that we had, like, skipped. Because we turned one way out of the spider caverns instead of going the other way out of the spider caverns. But then we went back up to the exit that we were going to take out anyway, so then we went through the other side of the mine. It's interesting doing that zone after having done it in missions, because with the missions, you don't really see how interconnected everything is, and then you go through it on landscape and you're like, oh hey, this is all like right together. And then we did a couple more things for our League of the Axe rep. But I think all of us managed to get either the return. Well, I got my guide, but I think everybody else managed to get the return. And then finally, if you got the muster on your warden.
Right.
So yeah, that was fun and entertaining. And now my hunter can port to either end of the Wildwood, which is nice. In Star Wars, I ran some characters alongside Celebathian, and now I'm really having to resist making a new sniper, because I'm watching her sniper go through stuff while my bounty hunter is going through stuff, and she made a male agent, and I'm like, yeah, I really want to do this. Like, I want to duo it with a male agent and female agent, because it's same story is slightly different depending on gender, because later on, it didn't actually matter what gender you were, but in the original portions of the game, certain options were only available depending on what gender you were. And so, yeah, it's really interesting running duo that way.
Are you saying that they don't allow female snipers and others to seduce their marks like they do the males?
No, you do, but you can only seduce the opposite gender. The original classes in the original class stories in Star Wars, in the original part of the game, which is pre-expansions, because in later expansions they actually opened it up for same gender flirting, but in the original parts of the game you can only do opposite gender flirting. Which came under criticism at one point, which is why in later content you could do same gender, and there's been some talk back and forth about going back and changing that, but they haven't actually gotten around to doing it, and I don't know that they necessarily will, because that would require a lot of work, probably. But yeah, it's actually a thing, and so in the original parts of the game, like the stuff you're playing through now, the vanilla parts of the game, you can only flirt with the opposite gender, so male characters can only flirt with females, and female characters can only flirt with males. So, yes, story elements will be different depending on what gender you are. Which is interesting. And that's why I say you should always play each class twice, because you want to play it as each gender, just to see what different versions of the story you have. Plus, the story turns out differently depending on your choices, so you can... Like, the agent story has, like, 7 different endings, depending on choices you make through gameplay. And I haven't even seen them all, and I have, like, a dozen agents. And I still haven't gotten through all 7. Mostly because I keep forgetting to make the choices I need to make for 2 of them. So I've only seen 5 out of 7. But, yeah. That is a thing. And then in Civ 6, I now have scouts with cats! Scouts with cats is also a thing. It's really funny because Kiosaurus was talking about it the last time we were playing in our group, which was after last week's podcast, or maybe something on Sunday. I don't remember. I think it was after last week's podcast we were discussing it, because she and Pineleaf and Celebathian and I think it was just the four of us, were playing, and they had introduced the new thing where you could pet the dog, and you can pet the dog but not the cats. So we were trying to figure out how you go about getting cats, and we got through... The actual article describes extra steps that you no longer really need to take, apparently, so you really just need to, like, link your account, and then boom, done, and then start a new game. So yes, I now have scouts with cats, and it is amazing. It is really funny to watch the scout and his 3 cats running around on the little Civ map. Yeah, so that was me. How about you, Celebathian?
Well, didn't do much, actually. I've been kind of away doing other things this week. But as mentioned, I went through the Riffin set again. With our Tuesday group, Sans, yes, was just thrilled that we were going back. once again, Sans was also wanting to buy a race change coin for her characters. Apparently playing hobbits and other short races with, you know, entirely two gigantic spiders hovering around is not a good thing. But, you know, I don't know. I think it might be fun to limbo under, like, Shelob. But anyway,
I know Shelob's not there,
but, you know, just the equivalent of.
As the tall character, I can tell you it's really not that much more fun as the tall character.
Yeah, in the Tuesday group, she is the tall character, not,
in most,
you know,
groups, I'm the tall character.
As mentioned, I've mostly been playing Star Wars lately around my schedule. I recently created a Sith Assassin because that was, you know, one of the ones that you have to do. You have to play all eight of the classes through in order to get the legendary, what is it, legendary title?
Yeah.
So I'm going to have to wind up playing, you know, one of each of those, you know, eight through. So I went ahead and created them and, you know, I just, you know, I play. But this is the one that I just now created, the Sith Assassin. And I realized today that she apparently starts out with a glowy electric Q-tip.
You like Q-tips on your characters.
I know. Every time I turn around, my character is holding, is just wielding a Q-tip.
You should have known that because my character has the glowy.
It did not sink in until literally earlier today when I was looking and I was like, it's an electric Q-tip. So, you know.
I mean, granted, the training version really does look like a Q-tip and the saber looks more like the dual saber.
But, you know, it's, you know, electric toothbrushes, electric Q-tips, same thing. No, not really. But I also, on that character, told my, I want to say it right, is it Deshade? Or Deshad?
Deshad.
The Deshad companion, which is kind of very monstrous. But kind of told my Deshad companion at one point to eat this overseer and this acolyte who were seriously bothering me. But right about that point is when my new Sith Master waltzed in and interrupted that good time. Anytime you can get your companion to eat your enemies in front of you is a good time for the Sith. It's like a little party. It's a little party in a box. And finally, just a notation from the game. Different characters. Salky, S-A-L-K-Y, does not equal salty. It is, however, way funnier to say that you're a salty mandible afterward. Yeah. Sometimes you feel like a nut. Sometimes you feel like a salky mandible. It's an item that you get from killing these bugs. And when I first saw...
Anyway, I would think that the salky mandible would be the thing that would be eating the...
Yeah.
No, it's a thing that you get off the bug that you sell as junk.
Yeah. And when I first saw it, I thought it said salty, but not. It's salky with a K. So I was kind of, you know, giggling over the fact it's a salty mandible. And, you know, I had picked it up and I thought it was very fitting because, you know, I've been very salty lately. And so I was like, yeah, I'm a salty mandible. And apparently, you know, this is an amusing thing. And I'm a salty mandible. I guess you had to be there. But Pineleaf, how about you? How was your week?
My week. I'll begin with my Honor Warden, who finished up questing in the Woods of the Woses, so doing all those quests in that area, and that means it's time for me to head into the Beacon Hills and start questing over there, where you would think that with the big emergency that it is to get the Rohirrim moving, that I would be just pushing on to the Pelennor right away, but no! I go back to where the Rohirrim have already been in order to try to hide the track of this great big army.
Well, did you take your broom, Pine? Because you need your broom. You're going to have to sweep away the tracks.
No, yeah, you just used some branches off of the pine trees.
Use some branches off of the pine trees. Yeah, I mean, a cavalry army has just gone through there. I think it'll be rather obvious where they went.
Ma'am, did you just say pine leaf needed to use pine branches? Wouldn't that mean that there's some stripping going on here? That's not right, okay? That's not right.
No, but the leaves are still going to be on the branches.
So you're just going to roll yourself on the ground, pine leaf?
During the field.
I mean, it's got to be at least as effective at hiding the tracks as anything else you're supposed to be doing.
But honestly, why is it surprising that, you know, this is happening? Because, you know, they tell you this is the most urgent thing in the world. You must do this very quickly. And yet there's literally like side quests from here to there that take you off like halfway across the country and back each and every time.
And somehow you're doing all of this in about 2 hours.
Yeah. And it's
and I managed to get back to the Rohirrim in time to be able to lead the way and clear the path in front of them as they head out to the battle. This is how long it takes to get that army remobilized.
It is a pretty big army. I mean, I guess it does take a little while.
Yes. During the field trip, we dusted off our 107 group that has been fallow for a while. If I remember correctly, I go into the character and it says, oh, you've got this present that you get from your bundle from the War of Three Peaks. That's right, all that War of Three Peaks merchandise, of course, popped into my inventory saying, oh, look at all this new stuff you just earned. So it's been a while since we've been on those characters. And it was time for us to start the questing in the Wood of the Woses. So a little bit behind this. But the 107 group, because we're 107, and thus we are a little bit above level for what we're doing right now, we're just going to be doing the epic until we finally get to the gates of Mordor. And based on the rate in which we've been playing these characters lately, I'd say it would be about 2025, 2026, I guess.
Oh, I thought you were about to say years. I was like,
we'll see. We'll see which version is right. And my main character in ESO reached level 40, so it's the first time I gotten a character up to level 40. And I decided to start giving the Greymoor storyline priority. I had done the very early parts of it, but I then got distracted by doing all these antiquities and then trying to do the mainline story thing. But for two reasons, I decided, let's give Greymoor priority. One of those reasons is because Blackwood, the next expansion, is coming out in early June, and I want to be finished with Greymoor before that happens. And second of all, I guess it puts off Cold Harbor a little bit more. And that concludes my week in LOTRO. In news beyond LOTRO, we have another wallpaper entry by Darren Loremaster, who gives the King of the Dead wallpaper version 2. I could not find version 1, so I don't know what happened to version 1. This is King of the Dead version 2. So we have the poem on the left side and the something from the King of the Dead on the right, which has the main image for the wallpaper. Actually, since I couldn't find version 1, I guess that means I haven't had a chance to read this yet, so let's try it. No curse like this of mine, King of the dead bound under oath to dwell in darkened halls, under the stony mounts where tunnels led from Dimholt to where Morthon Vale falls, past the Greenfoot Hills, where stands the old hill holding of Erichstone, near which I swore to aid Isildur. His oath binds me still and all my people to support his war. Isildur's heir shall summon us to fight one day, if he yet comes. For who can tell what doom shall come to pass? Here sable night surrounds us like a Stygian shades of hell. We spirits live, chained by the oath we broke, till we redeem the promise which we spoke. Our top supporter this month is LotraBuild.com. This is a collection of full Lotro databases, including an items database, relics database, and titles database. And also, you can get this right from your Discord server with a LotraBuild bot. We currently have 16 supporters on Patreon, and if you'd like to join this illustrious raid of players and help support Lotro players, you can go to the donations page. We can support the Players Alliance on Patreon. Your money will be used for podcast hosting, website hosting, and to pay for our live shows. The Players Alliance has two shows. On Wednesdays at 7 p.m. U.S. Central Time, we have DDO Players News, and on Saturdays at 8:30 p.m. U.S. Central Time, we have Lotro Players News. We don't have any emails this week, but we feel like since when you can send it to podcast@lochaplayers.com. You can also follow us on Twitter, Players Alliance at Players Alliance, Lochaplayers at Lochaplayers, Arendis at Arendis, Pineleaf at Pineleaf Needles, Sanswinda at Sanswinda, Teriadwin at Teriadwin, Guerindis at Guerindis, and Calabathian at Calabathian. And that concludes our show for tonight. And this is Pineleaf Needles reminding you to skirmish responsible.